All right, you guys hear me good?
Yeah.
Perfect. All right, we're live here tonight. Got the honor of Captain Ivan and Captain Lucas here tonight, and we're going to talk about the topic of tonight's going to be more or less boat preparation for the upcoming season. Seeing that I'm not fishing, I'm doing a little fishing on the river right now for steelhead, but I know Ivan's down in Florida, he's fishing, but there's really not a lot to talk about fishing up in this neck of the woods up in the Great Lakes right now. So we're just going to talk about what we do to get our boats ready for the upcoming season so that we can actually fish with them and not have them sitting, getting repaired. So I'm going to just turn it over to you guys, and you guys can kind of pick it off. Maybe Ivan, how you get your boats ready and what you kind of do.
So, we could start on a few different ways, right? The first thing I think we should maybe touch upon is, before we even go in the water, is ensure your boats properly. I thought about this after we talked today, Lenny, and, you know, many of my seminars, we used to do a skit on insurance, and many, many people are underinsured, and, we just had an incident. One of my friends just sank his boat here in Florida. And I mean, it's working out, but it could have worked out a lot easier having videos or pictures or having the proper survey done so you have the proper insurance to, if you have a big mishap, you know. And mishaps happen in the spring. They happen in the fall because in the spring, we rush to get them in. And in the fall, we're delinquent and getting them out early. You know, we always want to stretch that last week and we don't go see it. A lot of water, bilge pumps and all that. So that's number one. I think insurance surveys, that kind of stuff first. And then, you know, the natural just bottom paint, making it look good, checking through hulls. Through hulls throughout the winter on the Great Lakes, some of the backing on the through hulls will be wood, shrink. They'll expand. You put them in the water and they're wiggling. Now you got to pull the boat out again. So it's a good thing to go around, check your through hulls. We kind of do that as we're working on the boats. You clean them, check, clean, check, and go through that kind of stuff. But I'm like everybody else. I don't think we check them all, and I don't think I'm an expert at it. And it's, do as I say and don't do as I do, I guess. But I think that's where we would start. What about you, Lucas? Where are you starting with this stuff?
So I've actually had, I feel like I've had almost every kind of problem in the spring that you could come up with, which, you know, when you do this enough, you're going to have it. Mine was, I learned when I first started the charter business was at the end of the fall or in the beginning of the spring is I change my impellers on my boat, whether it's, you know, it's due or it's not due. I'm getting a new impeller every fall. So that in the springtime, I don't launch it, think everything's going well and overheat because I have had that problem with my old boat, not my boat now. And it was horrible. I had to call the Coast Guard because I overheated. I called the mechanic. The mechanic told me that the smoke coming out of the back was from the fogging. And it made sense at the time until it started turning black and, you know, I burned up the whole motor. So, you know, impellers, oil changes, all that stuff. If you don't get it done in the fall, it doesn't hurt to get it done in the spring before you dunk it.
Yeah, I agree on both of those accounts. What I try to do is make a list. And, you know, I do that at the end of the fall. I'll make a list of everything I think needs to be addressed. And the big factor, you know, with boats is you have to have someone that either fixes them or you can fix them yourself. And there's a fine line between you fixing stuff and somebody else that really that's what their job is and they're worth their weight in gold, the mechanics. I'm very fortunate. I have a good mechanic that works on my boat. And I make sure that I give him a list every year at the end when he puts it away for storage. And he's got all winter to work on it because it's very hard for, you know, the boat mechanics nowadays, they get swamped. And if you don't get them done in the off season. A lot of times they won't have time to do it once they start dropping boats. And so, like Ivan said, bottom paint is a huge thing. You know, if your boat is going to be slipped all year, we just take for granted that if it's painted, everything's good. And one of my buddies just bought a new Tierra that's in 87, and he had it, the whole bottom painted all stripped off. Cause he noticed there was some, looked like some cracks. And sure enough, when they blasted it, they found a bunch of hairline gel coat cracks all over the boat. And that was just pretty much from not maintaining it and not putting probably bottom paint originally on the boat when it was put in, into a slip. They probably just had the gel coat exposed for many, many years. And if that's one of those things where, you know, if it's out of sight, sometimes you don't see it. And that could have ended up continuing down into the fiberglass, and it would have probably hooked on moisture. So that was, you know, just one of those things. Make sure your bottom paint. I make sure my props are looked at every year. Make sure there's no dings in them. The shaft, make sure your shafts are nice and true, where you don't have any issue with that. Bilge pumps, you know, those are things that are real important. You know, everybody thinks that.
Yeah, I mean, we're talking about a lot of maintenance.
What's that?
I was just going to say, yeah, we're talking about a lot of major things. You know, I mean, some of these things, like, don't forget the plug in your boat needs to be talked about.
Yep.
You know, use Rain-X on your windshield. Get it ready for the year. It helps, you know, with splash and with rain. Make sure your safety equipment is up to date. Your flares are online, in, you know, they're good flares. You know, the Coast Guard will do a survey for you or an inspection for you, whether you're a pleasure boater or a charter captain.
Yep.
If you could even, I know in Rochester, you probably could even bring it to the Coast Guard station and they'll go through it for you. They won't write you a ticket. They're just going to tell you what you're missing.
Yeah. And depending on the boats, right. I always try to, wherever we could stop the water from coming in, right. That's if you can stop the water from coming in, you can pretty much fix anything once you're in the boat or in the water. And we had an incident in St. Catharines a few years ago. A guy come down from Quebec and his bellows were bad. Didn't realize it till he's out to the lighthouse, which is about a mile and a half from the marina. He almost didn't make it. That's how the margin of error was, you know, and I was 5 miles away from him and we never got there. We didn't get there prior to him coming in the marina on his kicker while he was sinking. That's how much time we didn't have, you know, we didn't have that much time and water's like 43 degrees. Right. And one hair on a bellows packing for us, you know, if you got shafts, your outdrive boots and all that stuff. It can, you know, outboard bolts, something that people don't necessarily check. Your kicker, you know, all those bolts, right? So I think we're talking about some of the stuff, like you said, Lucas, major stuff pre-entering the water, right? And it's important. Once we get in the water, I think it's, you know, it changes the game, right? I mentioned today to Lenny, I think one of the things I learned in Florida here, we're taking some pretty long runs, is a ditch bag. And in the ditch bag, spare bilge pump, 20-foot of hose, 30-foot of hose, cheap white hose, you know, like the, you know, the coiled stuff, alligator clips to a battery can save your boat. And a 2,000 gallon an hour bilge pump is $100 and could save your life and your boat. You know, we had a bilge pump last year just clog up, and my live well was taking on water a little bit. It's seeping, but over 7 or 8 hours, there was a lot of water in the bottom. I was a little nervous, you know, so ditch bag. The other thing is, West Marine sells these cones. They're foam cones with ribs. I don't know if you ever guys ever seen them. They're red. Any hole or anything, you can just jam in there and stop it. Well, now they make them in two, maybe three different sizes. They make a little one for any through hauls, so you don't have to jam that big deal in. And to tell you how good they are, we had an exhaust hose on my lures go bad, and the exhaust is about maybe 7 or 8 feet long, all the way down the side of the boat. And to change the hose, I didn't want to pull the boat out, but I had to take it off, and it's half underwater. We plugged that from the outside of the boat for 3 days. It was plugged. I took the hose because we had to order the hose, took it off, redid all kinds of work, put it back in, and never leaked one second. So here's something that could save you, you know, in a ditch bag. E-perps, they're not really standard here on the Great Lakes, but I think, you know, if you got one, great. I think they're an outstanding unit. We have one here, one of our buddies that carries one in the ditch bag, kind of like it. I don't know, whatever else you can throw is a safety kit, surf, a first aid kit in there, other than what you have on the boat, you know, and you always carry that bag around. And I think it's an important gig, man. I really do.
Yeah. One thing I try to do too is usually when I do a shakedown trip, and usually my boat's first in, and I usually put it in usually the first week of April, and I'm out of Manistee. And so we're fortunate we have a Coast Guard station right there, right on and at the lake. But what I usually do is I'll just do a trip around the pier heads, you know, do a little bit of fishing right at the pier heads, make sure everything's good. You know, don't go running, you know, 5 to 10 miles offshore on your first trip out. You know, usually just try to stay home within, you know, a quarter mile to a half a mile the first couple trips, just to make sure everything's what it's doing, what it's supposed to be doing too. I think that's huge for anyone, just a little shakedown cruise.
And a buddy system. If you got somebody in the marina, you know, why go by yourself when you can go two guys, right? Or two crews out. You can always help somebody if they need you or you need them, right? So I think it's important. I mean, we're talking about safety stuff, which is cool. Let's talk about fun stuff. Bringing your gear on board, all that new gear, storing and stacking, right?
Keeping you spend it the money, yep. You might as well bring it with you.
Yep, yeah. Exactly.
Bring what you own and run what you bring, right? Isn't that what we always say?
I know this year there's going to be a lot more new gear, you know, when it comes to lures. You know, I've been stockpiling, you know, e-chips with pro trolls and spin doctors. You can't find them at the, you know, during fishing season. So right now, a lot of people are stocking up right now, no different than Matthew with all his products. It's really smart this upcoming year. I mean, I said it before, but you better buy a lot more of the stuff that you know you're going to use this year and have it on hand before the season even starts, because once it starts, you might not be able to find it. So
I'm actually at a loss now, because I normally do all my stocking up at the Niagara Outdoor Show. You know, I get to meet Matthew. I get to see, you know, Anglers Avenue, ITO Flies. I get to see all these guys and see the new stuff and buy it. You know, you get discounts and everything else. And, you know, with COVID, that stuff's over with. So I still don't have new stuff I could bring on the boat for the spring yet, because I haven't been able to get anything and I don't want to buy it online quite yet. I want to go to a Hamburg Outdoor Show or things like that and see what's going on. Yeah, so I'm kind of behind the eight ball on all the new stuff that I'm going to use for this year.
Is Hamburg having their show this year? Are they having?
I don't even know yet. I think so. As of right now, as far as I know, they are. But
I know that
I'm looking at our list. If someone that's on here can let me know if they see it there.
One of the things we had
a question here, guys. Larry was wondering if we tape our flashers. I know I buy a lot of flashers, like chrome ones, and I'll customize them with tape and stuff. So yeah, I probably retape 50% of the flashers that I own and customize them to whatever is working, or just try new stuff. So that's just for Larry. He was wondering if we retape. How about you guys? Do you retape your flashers?
I don't really retape my flashers, and it's not because I wouldn't. It's because I don't really find the tape very available. Unless I go up to Fat Nancy's, I don't really have too many places around here with tape. That, I mean, I'm in Rochester, so we don't have a lot of a lot of places that even offer that unless I need something important that I can order online.
And I don't, I don't retape much at all. Maybe we call it lazy or whatever, but I think I do a lot of work with Dreamweaver. We've been working for him and with him for years. I think I don't even use much custom stuff. You know, we, Russell, at Anglers Avenue has probably the nicest custom stuff that I've seen. Of our product. And we use some of his stuff. And other than that, out of the box, we try to get using. And it's rare that, it's rare on a spin doctor that the tape falls off, right, to retape it. So unless you're buying blanks like you are and you're trying to make your own custom stuff, I mean, if it doesn't work, you just change another one, right? And
yeah, I mean, lures are a different story. Lures, the tape will come off those.
Correct.
We all know the Michigan Stinger issue. Those are all problems. But like you said, the flashers, the dipsies, that stuff, I would say maybe one or two have ever been damaged enough where I needed to either repaint them or give them away to somebody else and buy another one.
Yeah. I got a question. The question that we're going to have for tonight. So everybody out there, like and share this so that everybody else can have a chance at this. But the question of the night was, how many hours do you go before you change the oil in your boat? That's going to be the question of the night. And then whoever answers that first is going to receive the prize, which I think is going to be a hat tonight. I'm at this tonight's drawing. So, but that's going to be the question. So after, maybe if you guys see that, maybe in like 10 minutes or so, you guys can kind of your feedback on that too. Cause I know that's a huge thing with our boats, making sure we change the oil enough on them, keep them running right and get as many hours out of a boat as you can. So.
Yeah. So to touch back on bringing product, be back on that real quick. Last year was the first year I did this. And I don't know what your marinas or how close you guys live to your boats. But in our marina, they allowed me to bring a trailer, an enclosed trailer in right behind the boat. And I had one side of the wall was like all pegboard. Did pegboard. And we sell just our generic clothing, But once you have long sleeve, short sleeve, and all that stuff. So we have a wall full of clothing, hats, cups. We have all our extra spin doctors, hooks, whatever you need. All your consumables, right, is on one wall. And the other wall is all our tools. Because one of the things I found is that it's hard to bring a full DeWalt cordless kit on the boat and keep it on the boat all the time. We keep it in the trailer. You need it, you go get it, you put it back in. Keeps everything nice and tidy. And over the year, I found I was buying extra line and getting extra stuff and stockpiling my trailer, And when we stockpiled the trailer, I found that I had my own little tackle shot. What that helped, and let alone just getting the product, is I wasn't running to the tackle shop every 3 days to replenish. I replenished at the end of the year or in the start of the year, And so if as a charter operator, I'm not talking about the average guy that goes to the ramp. I'm talking any charter operator that's listening. If you guys have the opportunity to do something like that, you can get a 5x8 enclosed trailer. And it's pretty spectacular once you have it set up. We pay the marina a parking fee for it. And I think it's life changing for us. Between trips, you need a special screwdriver. It's in there. You're carrying the minimal in your boat that you need, but the extra is always 10 feet away as soon as you get the dock, right? So
yeah, and that's something that I've been lucky enough where everything I've needed, a belt, you know, spark plugs, a wrench, a socket, something. I have it, even a hose clamp, extra electric butt connectors, anything. And I have all that on my boat, but I've also, I mean, we all own boats. Even if you're a weekend guy, you could have that unique situation where your downrigger just got pulled loose and you can't get it to work again. My marina, we are intertwined with the weekend fishermen. We have guys that spend the weekend just fishing, and they have a problem where they need a special wrench or a twist tie or a zip strip or something like that. And, you know, we're always approachable. Come on up, talk to us, and we'll help you the best we can. And we're all out there to do the same thing. It's not like a gigantic competition with someone that wants to take their son out fishing. You know, and the same holds true for tackle. I mean, like you said, I have a lot of tackle. I always, like I said, I go to the outdoor shows in the wintertime. I stock up on stuff that I don't need, pretty much spend money because I'm a fisherman. But, you know, if something's working or, you know, I'm using a certain torpedo diver that's working great, I probably have three or four of them. I'm not afraid to take the weekend guy who's going out with his son and walk him through it. I mean, those are things that I've learned over the years that when I get on my boat in spring and I'm going to start for the season, I have enough. And that's kind of what we're trying to talk to about everybody about is the little things you got to remember, when you start for the year is, you know, make sure the plug is in your boat when you launch it, you know, make sure you have, possibly an extra belt or, something that you could possibly fix to get you back to shore if you need it. That's for charter captains as well as, you know, the guy in the 14-foot low, you know.
100%.
Just trying to help everybody out.
Yeah, I remember probably one of the funniest stories that I've ever seen. When I was probably started fishing about 30 years ago, I took my boat down to St. Joe, Michigan, and coho fishing was really good. So I trailered my boat down. I had a 25-foot sports craft, and I went down there, and I pulled up to the boat ramp, and I seen a boat that was sitting at the dock in the water. And as I backed my boat down and went to get out to release my trailer there, I noticed the lady was standing. There was a lady in the boat, and she was standing on her seat of the boat. And she asked me, she's like, "Sir, I got a question for you. Is this normal?" And I looked over at her as she's standing on her seat, and the boat was about 8 inches of water in the bottom of the boat. And I was like, "No, ma'am, that's not." So I got the boat off with my trailer, backed underneath her boat, pushed it out as far as I could, and then my buddies hooked it up, and we winched it on my trailer, even though it was the wrong size, and I pulled it out, and the water was coming out of it for probably 10 minutes, and her husband started walking down from the party store, and he goes, "What's my boat doing on that trailer?" And she goes, "You forgot to put the plug in your boat, and it was sinking." And, I mean, the motor was running when I came up and pulled up there, so the thing would have eventually went down in 10 minutes if we wouldn't have just happened to show up. So
it was probably
all your help.
It was probably her fault anyway. Don't worry. Probably her fault. She wasn't listening.
Yeah. Oh, man. So, I mean, it's the simple things, like you said, that you have to look for, that, you know, sometimes people just overlook, you know, and they can get you in trouble, especially if, you know, I've heard stories of people going out and start fishing, and then all of a sudden, you know, the bilge pump kicks on. They're like, "What's this kicking on for?" You know, the first trip, and people forget that quite commonly. And then you got to run back, and hopefully, you make it back, which most people do, as long as you're running, you know. But
I would think there's a majority of us, and I'm going to say us because I did it, that have forgotten their plug at some point in their life.
Oh, just one? No, minimum.
I don't know too many guys that haven't done it, you know.
Done it once on a jet ski, two or three times on a duck boat. Yeah, it happens.
It happens. We're in a rush. You know, we don't want to miss the bite. You don't want to do this. You just get all the gear. You get talking. You think your buddy's doing it. He thinks you're doing it. Here you go. It's her fault. you know?
Yeah. I don't even know who this poor lady is, but I'll blame her for every time I mess up too.
Exactly. Yeah. That's it. It's her phone. It's fantastic.
Hey, I want to thank everybody that's putting comments up here. I don't get to see a lot because my phone's locked up, but I'm seeing some people saying good evening to us. It's nice to interact with everybody. Lenny, are you seeing? Arion says that Tony, and I want to say this name because I've been looking at it. Sizanowski is supposed to spin the wheel. I saw that on the Facebook Live thing. I don't know if that's.
I haven't seen that pop up yet. I'm looking right now at all of them. I know that they. I don't see a correct answer yet for the hours. I've seen 100 hours. I personally will give you a hint. I do it under 100 hours for everyone out there. So maybe if you guess something under 100 hours, you're going to probably have a better shot at it. So. I don't know. Do you guys do yours under 100 hours for your each motor or one motor?
Well, I think depending on, we have a few different boats, but my diesel, we do 150 hours. Do it in the spring, do it midway through the season. And you know, we all think we put a lot of hours on our boats, you know, and, I think 500 hours is probably a real high number for somebody per engine. If on a twin engine boat, our twin engine boats are running around between 300 and 400 a year. So it's 3 oil changes a year. It's pretty quick to do. And it's pretty inexpensive, right?
He got the right answer. The answer that I, you know, had come up with and what I do is 80 hours is what I do on my boat, both my engines. Every 80 hours, I'll change the oil on it, which a lot of times, you know, I've heard people say that's too early. But usually if you look at the oil and it starts getting that darker, a little bit darker color to it, if you look at it, it's right, usually around 80 hours is when I do it. So I got 454 Crusaders.
Yeah, we have one of their 454s. It's got 7,600 hours on it, you know, and it's crazy. We rebuilt the other one. We blew the block on the other one. I think it just wore through. It had over 8,000 hours on that one, on a Crusader.
That's real bad.
They're pretty amazing engines, those Crusaders. If I had to vouch for an engine, every Crusader I have is bulletproof, and every other engine I have is a POS, you know. we seem to rebuild the other ones every 4 years. The Crusader, we just don't touch, you know.
I found because I got 454 Crusaders that turned, they were right before I bought the boat, they bored them out to 502s. And I want to say I do it based on the number of charters and if I'm running offshore or not. But I'm saying about 100 hours, maybe more if I'm doing a lot of close stuff where I'm just, you know, out for a couple of hours. But I would say probably 150 hours, 200 would be my max for sure. And every time I do that, I'm also doing a tune-up as well.
And you guys make me feel like I'm a worrywart doing it 80 hours then. I mean, I just, every time I look at that oil and it starts getting black, I just start thinking, man, there's wear going on, so it's time to change it. So,
yeah.
Yeah, I have black oil. Don't worry. Black lives matter to you, you know. We use our oil is dark. My oil is not golden like yours, that's for sure. But I'm 150 to 200. 150 okay. For sure.
Lenny, you'd be safe to change it every 20 hours if you want.
No, I mean, I'm not that picky, but I mean, I look at it, you know, like Yvan said, even that if the more you change it, the less you're going to have to worry in the end.
Right. I agree.
Yeah.
And it's pretty easy. If I had one vessel, I would put an onboard oil changer in right in. I saw Grant Coppers. You guys know Live Target, right? Everybody's heard about Live Target.
Yeah.
Grant, the owner of Live Target, used to charter beside us before he started Live Target. He was the first one back in the 90s. He had an automatic oil changer right in his boat, hoses off the oil, the bottom of the oil pan, and basically it took him longer to take the oil off and pour it than to suck it out. It was the slickest thing I've ever seen. So if you're changing your oil pretty quick, you don't even have to bring anything down to the marina to change it. You just push the button, it comes out, you put oil in, you bring the bucket home. 2 seconds.
I think
5 or 6 minutes you're changing the oil per engine.
It's harder for me to get the floors up to get to the motors than it is to actually change the oil.
Yeah, right. It's just a little bit of time, but what type of boat you running? 10 meter Trojan?
31 open Tierra.
And Lucas, what are you running?
I got a 10 meter Trojan.
Yeah, that's what I thought. Yeah. Man. Very cool, man. Very cool. They're great boats. Both your boats are fish catching machines, you know.
So you guys train, you change your transmission fluid every year then? That's what I typically do is every year I'll just change the transmission fluid in the Velvet Drives.
Yeah. In the spring we do that every training we try to.
And also don't forget, I mean I just noticed this year and I the boat's only to me is only like 3 years old, but my trim tab oil was non-existent. I didn't check that. So now that I'm putting in autopilot, I mean, you got to check your trim tab oil. You got to check all that.
Yeah, your power steering. I had a couple leaky valves that I had fixed this off season that were leaking out. They would bleed out in every probably 10 to 12 trips that I have to put, maybe 4 ounces in there because it was just getting a little sucking it, pushing it out. So
that's probably the simplest thing is that steering. And it sucks when it goes. If you ever had to go home without steering and your rudders are locked up where you got to go down and disconnect it to turn them, you'll never want to do that again.
Nope.
That's for sure.
No.
We got locked up. We got locked up once where the rudder turned, locked up. We couldn't even get it undone inside the boat. There's no way to get home. You're going in circles. It was unbelievable. We had to get towed in and we just couldn't run, Yeah. So.
Well, I appreciate you guys joining tonight. Thanks for all your input and everything. And I appreciate it. And just have a good night. And thanks for everyone for watching tonight too.
Yeah. Awesome. Thanks for everybody taking the time out and the questions and everything. Congratulations to the people that did their winnings and hopefully we'll see you in a couple weeks here.
Man, we're only 65 days till launch, eh, boys?
You bet.
Oh, yeah. I don't even know if it's that long, honestly. So, yeah, it's 40, happening.
45, 40 for me.
So. What, I might actually go out and put my plug in the boat this week just because we talked about it. I think we're jinxed. Just going to go put it in now and just make sure.
All right, boys.
Have a good one, guys. Appreciate it.
All right. Thanks, everybody.
See ya.
Bye now.